You know how big a trillion is?
It's a billion million.
Yeah, but if I started right now, and I started counting one number every second, one, two, three, four, five, how long would it take me to reach a trillion? 32,000 years.
Wow.
And that's if I didn't sleep or didn't take any breaks. If I worked a good old public employee work day, or if I worked an 8-hour day counting, it would take me 96,000 years. See, the problem with spreading the word and getting more people to help combat big government is that we don't deal in personal terms. I believe what we have to talk about is what I describe as the kitchen table agenda. The kind of things when the family gathers around the kitchen table, or husband and wife gather around the kitchen table, and they go over the family budget and what's going on, numbers they can actually wrap their arms around. And it starts with $4 a gallon gasoline. Why do we have $4 a gallon gasoline? It's because of government. You know, I hear all these people saying, well, we shouldn't be drilling in Anwar or opening up the Gulf Shores or all of these public lands that we have. We have a trillion barrels of recoverable oil in the U.S. if the government would let us go after it. But we have all these resources. They say, well, don't bother with it because it would take 10 years for that to come to market and actually make a difference. You know how long they've been saying that?
30 years!
About 20 or 30 years, exactly. So right now we have the Obama administration cutting off drilling permits, retracting EPA permissions, stopping hundreds of wells in Wyoming alone, not opening up Anwar, all of these things, and it makes our energy supply fragile. So that even the disruption in Libya disrupts our prices. We've got to tell people the reason that you have $4 a gallon gasoline is because of the federal government. Not only that, take a look at your electric bill, which President Obama told people under my energy plan your electric bill would skyrocket. The best projections under what they tried to get through, cap and trade and otherwise, was that it would raise your average home electric bill by about $150 a month. How many of you want your electric bill up $150 a month? How does that compare to $4 a gallon gasoline? It's because of the government. And they have the EPA that has all these new energy standards and requirements that will make energy more expensive, and it makes everything cost more because energy costs more. And what does President Obama say we're going to do? Well, you need to buy a car that gets more than 8 miles a gallon. We're going to raise the fuel requirements, the EPA mileage requirements. Well, the car dealers said, okay, under the latest EPA requirements, every car is going to cost $5,000 to $7,000 more. You're going to have to be able to afford a lot of $4 a gallon gasoline to make up for the extra cost of the car that government dictates you have to buy. It's kind of like the appliances. I cannot believe they're advertising. You can buy a government-approved energy-efficient washer for only $1,000. And they don't work right. They don't get your clothes as clean. Like the good old $200 washing machines. And how about the light bulb? How much energy do you have to save in order to justify paying $5 or $10 for one light bulb as opposed to 25 cents? Oh, that's the next one. Getting in trouble with the EPA for that as well. But government has driven up the price of light bulbs. And let me tell you, I've read the studies from Cal Poly and Rensselaer Polytech. It's not just your perception. The light quality is not as good. And has anybody ever found a bulb that really does last 3 or 7 years? Anybody?
No.
Anybody?
No.
I bought one that was rated for 7 years and it lasted 3 weeks.
From in China.
But I still have that. So we have all these government requirements that are driving up your cost of living. But it doesn't stop there. I saw some college Republicans over here. Why is it the college costs keep going through the roof? Because government keeps saying we're going to give more college loans and more college grants, and the universities say thank you very much, we'll raise the prices. However much you say you'll give, we'll raise the price to accommodate that. You can't get ahead that way. It's like a big sponge that soaks everything up. Or you ever buy one of these little toy pills? You'll put the pill in water and it grows into a great big dinosaur. That's what happens with college tuition. Whatever government says we're going to do to help people, they raise the cost to make up for it. You begin to see the pattern here that we have to tell people that big government is not your buddy. It's the cause of so many of the things that you cannot afford in life. How about health care? Why does health care cost so much and therefore health insurance cost so much?
Regulations.
Anybody know? Right now, there's somebody, they had a heart attack because they saw the latest bill.
Their tax bill.
We have, and this is an old figure, so it's worse than this now, we have over 136,000 pages of federal rules and regulations on health care. PricewaterhouseCoopers documented that for every hour they spend with a patient, the doctors and nurses and providers have to spend at least a half hour, usually a full hour, doing the federally dictated paperwork. We don't have anything that's more bureaucratic, more regulated, and therefore more expensive than health care. Plus, the government says, well, we're going to pay for people's health care, but we're going to put price controls on it. So they say, wait a minute, how do we get back our money? Charge everybody else more. If you're getting health care paid for by any place other than government, depending on the figures you go by, 25 to 30% of your bill is not paying for your health care. It's paying for somebody else's health care that got it through government price-controlled health care. All of these things are why you will be paying for health care, and government come in and say, oh, we'll fix it with more government when what we need is less. And let's talk about, now we know that big taxes kill jobs. I don't even need to go there, do I? But how about the thing that started our Great Recession recently? The collapse of housing. It's more than that. You see, the reason why were so many people making so many bad loans? Because all the loans, yes, were being fed into Fannie and Freddie. We'll take the loan off your hand. But they had a requirement dictated by Congress of a federal quota. And it got up to as high as 28% of the single family loans were required by federal law to be issued to the lowest strata of income. It was such that under requirements of Congress put in place by HUD and worked through Fannie and Freddie, 28% of the housing loans had to go to the people who were at the bottom one-sixth of income levels. Now, if you're at the bottom one-sixth of income, you probably ought to be renting. But if you say that 28%, more than a fourth of all the single-family mortgages, have to go to people that are at the bottom one-sixth, you're going to make millions of bad loans. And this was dictated by a law passed by Congress and implemented through HUD and carried on through the Clinton years and through the Bush years, and now it's been transferred over to FHA. Government requires them by law to make loans to people who cannot afford to pay. And after that had been going on for about 15 years, the system collapsed. And all of us in our entire economy are paying for that. So whether you're talking about the decline in the value of your home, the unaffordability of college, the unaffordability of health care, the unavailability of credit, the higher credit card rates, thanks to federal reforms, the price of gasoline, the price of energy, the price of a car, the price of appliances, I forgot to tell you about the fact that ethanol lowers your fuel mileage.
Oh, yeah.
And is driving up the cost of food.
Yeah.
All of these things that people talk about around the kitchen table are unaffordable thanks to the federal government. You cannot have enough subsidies. You cannot have enough transfers of wealth to make up for all of this damage. We've got to tell people in terms that make sense to them in their everyday household budget. The kitchen table agenda says government has got to stop doing the things that make it less possible for you to support yourself and push you into the arms of an ever warm, loving embrace of Big Brother. And I want to challenge you as members of the Tea Party movement to look about it, to look about and see how you can help people understand that government is the problem, not the solution. Not just by telling them about the billions of dollars and the trillions of dollars, but telling them what it means to them in their own personal life. You know, I believe this country was founded on certain principles that require individual personal responsibility.
Yeah.
And right now, some people are intimidated away from that. And that's because we have political enablers in the system. Political enablers who say it's okay to ask for more government. It's okay to ask government to take care of your health care or your mortgage payment or whatever it may be. It's okay to ask government to do more and to find scapegoats because, after all, it's owed to you. These are political enablers telling people it's okay to be selfish rather than thinking about the impact on the next generation. And it's the equivalent, I believe, of if a minister gets up in church and tells people it's okay to sin. And they say, well, I know this is responsible behavior because the preacher told me it was. We have too many people in politics telling people that it's responsible to be dependent on government. And I'm here to say it's not. I believe that America is founded on four fundamental principles and pillars of freedom, free enterprise, faith, and family.
Yeah!
We've got to strengthen all four. America. That's great. But you know what I say? I say it's time for America to bless God.
Amen.
Thank you.